Howdy, folks. Made a little more progress on this Kelvinator. As you can see, the condensing unit is painted up. I used a blue color that's the closest one I could find to the original Kelvinator color. It definitely looks a lot better than it did all rusted up. So the next thing is going to be to pre-wire the start relay where it can be bolted on here, and then try and dress some of the cables up. So I've got all the wiring ready for the Kelvinator. This is the original hot wire start relay. I couldn't bear to take it apart and convert it into a PTC. It is worn, and I've had trouble with these, so it's going to remain a relic. It's going to go back with the fridge. I had another one that wasn't in good shape. I took the hot wire relay off and I put a Supco RO81 system in it. And I had to take it apart and mount it this way where it'll lay flat and go inside the housing. But it's the overload for the 1/5 to 1/12 horsepower compressor. This is a 1/8, so that's just right. And this has a long reset delay, so if it does trip, it gives it plenty of time to cool off. This is the PTC start device that gives the single pulse to the start winding when it's turned on. So the power comes in here where that black wire is soldered on, goes through the circuit breaker, and then it goes directly to the M contact. That's your run winding or main winding. So whenever the thermostat turns on, it puts power on here, and the M winding is energized all the time the thermostat's turned on. But then, as you see, the PTC start device, for about 1 second, it bridges these two together. So the first 1 second of power, immediately the M turns on, and then power goes through this PTC device into the S. So for that first second, they're both on. And then after this reaches its time limit, gets hot in there and reaches its time limit and turns off, the start one turns off. And then you're left only with the main or run operating. So I've got the original casing here. I'm gonna put this together in the casing and then put these wires on to build up the circuit. So the relay is snapped back together. And I'm going to start with the cabinet cable here, which will go to the thermostat and the light in the cabinet. And it has a switched live wire. And as I was saying earlier, that is the one that is the power input to the compressor. Goes through the circuit breaker. I'm going to attach it right there. Not going to tighten them real tight just yet. Then the other ones are the live from the cord and the neutral from the cord. The live from the cord is going to that far corner terminal point. So this is a flat type cord, a modern cord. So the one that doesn't have grooves on it is the live. One with the grooves is the neutral. So take the live side of the cord. There's some longer screws that will go through two wires. I'm going to gang those together and then put it into that point there. And again, these ones in the corner on the start relay, there's no connection internally to the relay. They are only a junction block point. So that has the cabinet cable live and power cord live in there loosely. Next one will be the neutral. Same story with that. You know, it's it doesn't do anything inside the relay, it's just a junction point. But the neutral also has the compressor neutral on it, so I've got to put three wires on that point. Cabinet cable neutral, which does the light, the compressor neutral, and the power cord neutral. And those all go on one of the junction block points here that doesn't have any internal connection to the relay. And like I said earlier, I'm not tightening any of them. I'm just getting them where they're in position. Then I can maneuver them, manipulate them later, and dress them where I want them. Then over here we have the run wire to the compressor. And it goes to the M terminal here. And then the last one is start. It's going to go to S. Now the M and S, there's only one wire that goes to each one of them. So it's generally pretty easy to get them dressed like they need to be, because there's just, you know, it's just one wire. So you just tighten them up and that's the way they're going to be. But down here is where it's got to be done just right. The switch live is this red wire. Tighten it down. Of course, it complicates things trying to video it all, but I just want to show what I'm doing. So I don't like the way those lay across each other right there. I'd like to see them spread out a little more, like so. And then the grounds will come out of that slot, go to a grounding screw. So that's the general idea of how I want this relay to be. The wires that go to the compressor come out through this slot, and they are on the M and S terminals. All the neutrals are tied together right there, the cord, cabinet cable neutral for the cabinet light, the compressor neutral to the common on the motor, and then the live side, those two are tied together. It just goes there and goes from the cord directly to the cabinet cable, and that takes powers the thermostat and the cabinet light. So I think this can be mounted back on the condensing unit now. One last thing that I want to show, this is a piece of Nomex paper, insulating paper. It'll sit below the relay like that to provide some secondary isolation, so that if anything happens in here, it's not going to have a direct path to ground. Y'all are going to have to forgive the background noise, but the heater's going back there. So there's two places on here that take grounding screws, and I want to grind the paint around them. That way we've got a good connection there for ground, for safety. Then there's a bonding jumper that's going to go from the compressor to here. I put a little bit of this corrosion inhibitor. Well, that was a little more than a little bit. That will help to ensure that moisture doesn't creep in there over time. Then this other end, I'm not going to hook up just yet. Come up here with the piece of Nomex paper. Put it down. I'm going to put one relay screw in place. And all these cables are the way I want them in there. Nothing's going to get pinched. Theory. Just checking to make sure no wires are underneath the relay and get pinched in there or crack the relay housing. Should be able to run these down. All right, it's got the rebuilt hot wire relay with the PTC device in it. Now I'm going to take these other two grounding wires. I think that fitting may be a little bit small. I'll probably go ahead and run the screw through that one to start with and get it in there. And that goes like so. And then goes in there. Now the reason for this jumper, so the compressor is sitting on plastic bushings and springs, so it can't be guaranteed to be grounded to the frame. The condenser is hanging by rubber grommets for vibration isolation. It also isn't grounded to the frame. So in spite of the cord being grounded right here, the compressor and the lines might not be grounded, so we have to put this bonding jumper in place. And it's there because the compressor is not solidly attached to the framework. Just something that you need to do to make sure it is truly grounded safely. So now I'm going to get this part ready to hook up. It's time to hook up some compressor cables. I got some new terminal boots to put on there. Remember, this one here was common and start and run. Now I've labeled the wires with the tag maker, so we can put them on there like so. And then start was the center one. Run was by process of elimination the last one. I know they look like a mess right now, but like with the relay, I want to get them all in position or connected, and then go back and tighten them with them in the right position. These just need to be tight enough to make contact, because like I've repeated myself so many times on these early compressors that don't have glass fused terminals, the terminals are really delicate. You don't want to ever put any pressure on them, because that can result in a refrigerant leak. And, you know, that is often repairable, but sometimes it's not repairable without cutting the compressor open and fixing it from the inside. And I know that by a lot of people's standards, that's not repairable. These boots are, they're nice because they go all the way back over the washer part, and there's nothing, no exposed live contacts, but they're a little more difficult to install than the original style ones that were much smaller. But in my opinion, it's worth it, because it just keeps someone from touching it and getting shocked. Not sure that one's fully seated. Okay, I like it. So the wiring is done on the condensing unit. It is ready to go back in the cabinet when the cabinet returns from paint. This is the cable that will go up into the cabinet and take care of the cabinet light and thermostat. And of course, this is obviously the power lead. So to test this, it's very simple. When this is plugged into a socket, the smaller slot to the right. So if this goes in there, the smaller slot to the right is always the live. So if I take my meter and I check from the live side onto the cable here in the cabinet, the live side is the black wire. I should have a closed circuit. See, less than 1 ohm. If I check to the neutral, I have no connection. If I check to ground, I have no connection. So the live wire, and also to switch live, there's no connection. Live wire only goes through the circuit and directly to live on the cord, the cabinet cable. Now if I go to the neutral side of the plug, I should see the white wire is neutral. I should see a solid connection, 0.2. Nothing to ground. And then if I go to the switch live, I should see the compressor motor resistance, 3.4. And if I go to the grounding pin on the new cord, I should see a solid connection to ground, and then nothing to the others. And if I touch this to the unit, I should also see a solid connection to ground. So everything looks correct. Now on this cable that goes in the cabinet, we can ignore the ground wire because we know what that does. It's not really part of this active circuit. So we've got three active circuits that go in there. The live, which is power from the wall cord, and the neutral from the wall cord. Now these two go to the cabinet light circuit. The live one goes to the door switch through the light bulb, and then the light bulb neutral goes to this wire. So this one goes only to the light socket neutral. So I'll bend it out of the way because we're not concerned with it now. I'll just cap it off. So that leaves us with the live wire and the switch live. These two go to the thermostat. The live is shared. It'll branch off. It'll go to the light switch and the thermostat. And this switch live goes back to the compressor. So when the thermostat wants to run the compressor, it connects these two together. That closes the circuit. Current can flow from the cord through the compressor and cool the cabinet. And then when it's cold enough, it breaks the circuit. But for a test run, I'm just going to tie the two together as if the thermostat was in the on position. So we've got the neutral going nowhere because we're not simulating a cabinet light. The ground goes nowhere because there's no cabinet to ground on. And the live wire and switch live are tied together. That simulates a thermostat in the closed position. So that can set down there out of the way. And then we'll bring the power source here. So we're going to measure amps of current. We plug in the new cable for the compressor. We have a simulated thermostat in the run position. So let's flip the switch, see what happens. Fired right up. So as you can see, the cabinet cable comes out of the relay. I've got two clamps on it. I don't want it to get under the compressor because that can bounce down. Might pinch it. The same thing for the power cable, the cord. I've got it clamped where it can't get underneath there. Got the ground for the cabinet and power cable, bonding jumper to the compressor motor. And then the cabinet cable is going to follow the heat exchanger up the back of the cabinet to get its job done. No exposed wiring anywhere on here to get shocked. I hear boiling refrigerant. That's a positive sign. Already got frost. 2.15 amps, 145 watts. Sounds very nice. I know that blue is a little bit brighter than the original Kelvinator, blue-gray, I guess, but I like it. I think it really looks good on there. Sure does look better than the rust. And the it conceals the fact that the tubing is different types of material. The repairs that I made are always copper tubing because it's easy to work with. Factory used steel, well now you can't tell that this isn't original lines. Nash Kelvinator. Well, all right, folks, that's it for today's short video, just showing this going back together. And now it's going to get rolled in the corner and covered up until the cabinet is done. Then at that point, we'll see it again and see it all go back together. Thanks for watching.